Good morning, everyone. Today we are discussing anatomical and physiological disorders of esophagus and its management, etiopathogenesis and management of GERD, LPR, transnasal esophagoscopy. The presentation was shown on 23rd May and finalized on 26th May. Contents, I'll be discussing about the anatomy, anatomical disorders of esophagus, which I'll be covering hiatus, esophagus, Barrett esophagus, strictures, rings, wells, diverticula. Under the physiological disorders, I'll be covering achalasia, diffuse esophageal spasm, nutcracker esophagus, ineffective esophageal motility and secondary motility disorders. I'll be then discussing about the GERD, LPR, transnasal esophagoscopy, and then the references. Anatomy. Briefly about the anatomy. It's a fibromuscular tube. Esophagus is a fibromuscular tube which is around 25 cm long in an adult. The extension is from lower end of pharynx, that is C6 level, to the cardiac end of stomach, T11. It has three normal constriction. The narrowest constriction is at the level of the cricopharyngeal sphincter, which is around 15 centimeter from the incisors. And after that, the thoracic esophagus has other constrictions at the level of arch of aorta, which is around 22 centimeter from the incisors, and at the level of bronchus, left bronchus, which is around 27 centimeter from the incisors. These two levels are considered together. And finally, there is the lower esophageal sphincter at the diaphragmatic level, around 38 centimeter from the incisors. The walls of the esophagus, there are four parts. They are like four walls: mucosa, submucosa, muscularis propria, which includes the muscle layer, that is inner circular and outer longitudinal. And finally, we have the adventitial layer. We have two plexes also, that is Auerbach plexus and Meissner's plexus. Regarding the sphincters, we have upper esophageal sphincter, which is around 3 to 5 cm length, and it functions during the act of swallowing. And lower esophageal sphincter, which is around 3 to 5 cm in length, and it prevents any kind of reflux. Middle portion of the esophagus shows active peristalsis. Anatomical disorder, the squamous columnar junction is marked by the irregular Z line, which demarcates the line between the esophagus and the cardia of the stomach. The gastroesophageal junction is marked by the proximal margin of the gastric folds. So although the squamous columnar junction, the gastroesophageal junction are normally located at the same level, these two are not synonymous. In this diagram, as we see, for example, in the Barrett's esophagus, the squamous columnar junction is proximal to the gastroesophageal junction. it has migrated upwards. And in case of hiatus hernia, because of the hernia, we can see the gastroesophageal junction is proximal to the diaphragmatic hiatus. Now, hiatus hernia is a displacement of the stomach into the chest through the esophageal opening of the diaphragm. It mostly occurs in elderly past 40 years. There are two types, sliding and paraesophageal. In sliding, the stomach is pushed into the thorax in line with the esophagus. In such cases, reflux esophagitis is common. Ulceration and stenosis can occur, hematemesis can occur, and it is caused by raised intra-abdominal pressure. In case of paraesophageal hernia, a part of the stomach along with its peritoneal covering passes up into the thorax by the side of the esophagus. So the gastroesophageal junction remains below the diaphragm and the angle between the esophagus and the stomach is maintained. There is no reflux esophagitis and the symptoms mainly they present with the dyspnea on exertion due to the position of stomach in the thorax, and sometimes bleeding can be there. The image on the right top shows endoscopic view of the cardia of the stomach, and shows a paraesophageal hernia. So this is what I have explained now. It is in the pictorial form. The second image shows the sliding hiatus hernia, and the third one shows the paraesophageal hiatus hernia. So diagnosis is by barium swallow study. Treatment mainly is surgical. The hernia is reduced and diaphragmatic opening is repaired. Early cases and those unfit for surgery, usually we go for conservative management like sleeping with head and chest raised, avoidance of smoking, use of drugs that reduce acidity like antacids and potent pump inhibitors, weight control, and attention to the causes which raise intra-abdominal pressure. Coming to Barrett's esophagus, here the normal esophageal lining changes from stratified squamous to columnar epithelium. Commonly occurs in the Western countries, and the pathogenesis is because of chronic inflammation secondary to the acid, alkaline, and bowel reflux. It has a genetic predisposition. So basically, it's a metaplastic change which occurs. There's a high risk of developing adenocarcinoma of the esophagus. Diagnosis is by reporting of two separate specimens from specialist gastroenterologist pathologist. Dysplastic changes can occur, and they're subclassified as low grade and high grade. So basically, endoscopic surveillance is required in such cases to detect any kind of dysplastic changes that can occur or any progression to malignancy. The image on the first image shows Barrett metaplasia. As you can see, there's a salmon colored gastric mucosa which is extending into the distal esophagus. And on the top right corner, we see a nodular growth. This is the adenocarcinoma which has developed in the underlying Barrett esophagus. Treatment, we address the risk factors for reflux disease, prescribing proton pump inhibitors to reduce acid reflux, and endoscopic surveillance is required. For high-grade dysplasia, full staging to exclude any underlying malignancy with CT, flexible video endoscopy, and endoscopic ultrasound to be done. Also, endoscopic mucosal resection to obtain a more substantial biopsy might be required. Radiofrequency ablation. This is a newer endoscopic treatment used to destroy the dysplastic epithelium. It is indicated in high-grade dysplasia. This has to be done only when the complete assessment and staging have shown normal esophagus and the underlying adenocarcinoma has been excluded. For this treatment, repeated application is required. And potential complications are perforation and stricture formation. So always in this such cases, intensive endoscopic surveillance is must to detect any kind of dysplastic changes and malignancy. So the image on the left side shows Barrett esophagus, which is less than three centimeter. So it is short segment Barrett esophagus. Also, we can see the gastroesophageal junction. This is a long segment Barrett esophagus. Here, the columnar mucosa is extended longer than 3 cm above the gastroesophageal junction. And also, we can see islands of normal squamous mucosa. Surgery, esophagectomy, it remains the gold standard for high-grade dysplasia in Barrett esophagus as it provides a definitive cure. Indications for surgery are nodal disease, if it's evident on staging, suggesting of an undiagnosed invasive adenocarcinoma, when the length of Barrett esophagus is extensive or multifocal, esophagus otherwise abnormal, and patient is young. Coming to the next anatomical disorder, that is strictures. Stricture is defined as any loss of lumen area within the esophagus. The normal esophagus measures 20 mm in diameter, and the clinical symptom is dysphagia. This dysphagia is most prevalent when the luminal diameter is less than 15 mm. Etiology can be intrinsic and extrinsic. In intrinsic can be acid peptic induced, pill induced, chemical or lye induced after intubation, infectious esophagitis, sclerotropy, irradiation induced, also any malignancy, any surgical anastomotic thing, and congenital can be congenital. It can be secondary to any inflammatory diseases and skin disorders like epidermolysis bullosa. Under the extensive strictures, it's because of the mediastinal pulmonary malignancy, any anomalous vessels and aneurysms. So acid or peptic causes account for majority of the cases. Treatment for benign strictural disease is esophageal dilatation. The different types of dilators are used. Mercury-filled rubber Meloni boogies are used for uncomplicated short-stage strictures, and wire-guided rigid Severi Gillette's dilators and balloon dilators, which can either be passed through the scope or wire-guided. They are basically used for the long, tight and torture strictures. So this is an image showing Severi dilatation of esophageal strictures. This we can see, it's an endoscopic dilatation. The technique is through the scope dilatation of the esophagus. So the balloon is passed through the scope. And this is a Meloni dilatation of esophageal strictures. So the choice of dilator depends upon the anatomy of the stricture and the operator's experience. Complications can be perforation, bleeding and bacteremia. And radiation induced or malignant strictures, they have a high risk of perforation. So the rule of three applies here. That is, no more than three sequential dilatation should be done per session, and the goal should be diameter more than 15 mm. On the right side bottom, there is an image showing an endoscopic view of the passage of a guide wire through a esophageal stricture in preparation for the balloon dilatation. So refractive esophageal strictures. So when the lack of response to two or more dilatations, causes can be ongoing insult from the pills or anisitis, or uncontrolled acid reflux and inadequate lumen diameter achieved by dilatations. PPI are superior to H2 blockers in preventing recurrence of acid-based related strictures, and elimination of offending agents and gentle dilatation to 15 mm. Intralesional injection of steroids before dilatation is effective. Coming to rings and webs, they're mostly asymptomatic. Symptoms are intermittent solid food dysphagia, food impaction, aspiration, and regurgitation. So rings are the circumferential, can consist of mucosa or muscle, and mostly occurs in the distal esophagus. Webs occupy only some part of the esophageal lumen. They're always mucosal and are usually located in the proximal esophagus. Diagnosis is by barium radiography. On the right side, the image shows a circumferential web, Plummer-Vinson syndrome. This is a triad that consists of proximal esophageal web, iron deficiency, anemia, and dysphagia. Mostly occurs in female past 40 years. So the barium swallow in this case shows a web in the post-cricoid region, which is a thin eccentric lesion with a normal looking mucosa. It occurs due to subepithelial fibrosis, and around 10% shows to have a post-cricoid carcinoma, they develop post-cricoid carcinoma. Also, the syndrome predisposes to development of carcinoma in the tongue, buccal mucosa, pharynx, esophagus, and the stomach. Treatment is to correct the anemia by oral parenteral iron, also the associated vitamin B12 and B6 deficiency to be corrected, and for the webs, mechanical disruption can be done by boogie or balloon. Coming to the rings, Sasky ring, also known as B ring, which occurs at the gastroesophageal junction at the distal margin of lower esophageal sphincter. So the presence of symptoms depends upon the luminal diameter. If it's less than 13 mm, patient will have symptoms. If it more than 20 mm, patient almost never has symptoms. For diameter between 13 and 20 mm, symptoms are variable. Treatment is for the symptomatic patients, we can do dilatation and maintenance therapy with acid suppression. A ring is another ring which is lower esophageal muscular ring, rarely symptomatic and occurs at the proximal margin of the lower esophageal sphincter, approximately 2 cm proximal to the squamous columnar junction. So on the right side we see of the top right shows endoscopic view of the Sasky ring, and this is a barium swallow study showing Sasky ring in the lower esophageal junction. Esophageal diverticula is a sac that protrudes from the esophageal wall. Two diverticula consist of all the layers of wall. False diverticulum consists of mucosa and submucosa that have herniated through the muscular wall. It's classified anatomically into the 4 stages, Zenker's diverticula, mid-esophageal diverticula, epiphrenic and intramuscular pseudodiverticulosis. Zenker diverticula was also already covered in the previous seminars. I'll be discussing about the remaining three. And for the last one, intramural pseudodiverticulosis is actually not a diverticula, it's just the dilatation of submucosal glands. It can occur secondary to any motility disorders. Congenital diverticula are rare. So this image shows here that is epiphrenic diverticulum. These are, and also we can see in the image the gastroesophageal junction, and on the side we can see this epiphrenic diverticula. They are located near the diaphragmatic hiatus and occur in distal esophagus near the lower esophageal sphincter. These diverticula are often the result of a motility disorder like achalasia and difficult esophageal spasm. Mid esophageal diverticula, most commonly asymptomatic, and again there are like two types. Traction diverticula, it occurs because of the external pulling of the esophageal wall by neighboring inflammatory or fibrous tissue such as adjacent tuberculosis mediastinitis. It occurs in the middle third of the esophagus. It is a true diverticula. It can also be a pulsion diverticulum, where when the internal forces are applied to a portion of esophageal wall, it is related to the motility disorders. On the right side, we can see this is an image showing the mid esophageal diverticula. The inferior one is actually the gastroesophageal junction. Treatment mainly small diverticular asymptomatic, but for symptomatic patients like if they have chest pain or regurgitation with large diverticular should be offered treatment, which consists of managing underlying motility disorders and for symptomatic diverticular, diverticulotomy with or without myotomy can be done. Next is caustic injury, mostly accidental in children, and the remainder occurs in suicidal, psychotic, alcoholic adults. Lye is a generic term for a strong alkali, usually sodium potassium hydroxide. So caustic injury is more severe with the alkali substances than with the acidic substances. Alkali materials produce a liquefactive necrosis and results in rapid and deep tissue injury. In the stomach, there is a partial neutralization of the ingested alkali by the gastric acid, which results in a more limited injury, and acidic agents produce a coagulative necrosis that limit the penetration and injury. Early signs and symptoms often do not correlate with the severity and extent of tissue injury. Symptoms are oropharyngeal, retrosternal or epigastric pain, dysphagia or dynophagia, or hypersalivation. If the patient is having a severe persistent pain, it tells us that it can be because of the esophageal perforation or mediastinitis. Hoarseness, tighter respiratory difficulties are uncommon, but can result from the burns of epiglottis and larynx. Examination for the evidence of oropharyngeal injury, and if airway compromise is present, intubation may be necessary. Absence of oropharyngeal burns does not preclude the presence of esophageal or gastric injury. Thus, upper endoscopy is done in the first 24 to 48 hours after ingestion to evaluate the extent of the damage and establish prognosis and guide therapy. If the patient is able to swallow without any pain and vomiting, liquids can be started after 48 hours. Now this is a grade, this is a grading of caustic esophageal injury. 0 grade is normal, 1 is mucosal edema and erythema, 2A and 2B. 2A is superficial ulcers, bleeding and exudates, and 2B is deep focal or circumferential ulcers. 3A and 3B. 3A is focal necrosis and 3B is extensive necrosis, and 4 is perforation. So basically this predicts the subsequent clinical outcome. Patients with grade 1 and 2A have excellent prognosis without any acute morbidity or chronic stricture formation. They can be started on liquid diet and advanced to a regular diet in 1 to 2 days. Grade 2B and 3A, they have strictures in 70% to 100% of the cases. Grade 3B carries a 65% early mortality rate and high need for esophageal resection. They are usually located where the caustic agents pool, that is at the cricopharyngeus level of aortic arch and LES. They caustic strictures tend to be longer and tighter, and they are refractive to dilatation therapy, and they have a higher rate of complication with dilatation. 10 to 20, 50% may require surgery because of a lack of response. They have a late complication can be squamous cell carcinoma of esophagus, so endoscopic surveillance is must. If esophageal strictures form, they require esophageal dilatation. Coming to the physiological disorders of esophagus, I'll talking first about esophageal manometry. It's a diagnostic test. It measures intralaminar pressure and coordination of the pressure activities of the three functional regions of esophagus, that is both the sphincters and the esophageal body. So peristalsis is a coordinated contraction sequence quantified by the percentage of swallows with peristalsis. At the lower esophageal sphincter, it assesses the basal pressure and relaxation of the sphincter during the swallowing. And in the body, it assesses the amplitude and duration of the contraction and peristalsis. The image on the right side shows a normal esophageal manometry. So after the wet swallows are initiated here, we can see progressive peristaltic contraction in the body of the esophagus with amplitude from 30 to 180 mm of mercury. On the images, we can see on the right side is a conventional manometry. In the left side, it is the manometry which we use now. Here, if it's a blue color one, it shows a low pressure, and if the red one signifies the higher pressure. Its indications are to assess patients with symptoms suggestive of any esophageal motor dysfunction and any non-cardiac chest pain. And also evaluation of before any anti-reflux surgery is being performed. It can be solid-state catheters that contain embedded microtransducers that directly measure the esophageal contraction, or it can be water perfused catheters that contain small caliber lumens perfused with water from a low compliance perfusion device. So when the catheter port is occluded by the contraction of the esophagus, water pressure builds up, and that exerts a force that is conveyed to the external transducer. Electrical signals from the transducer are transmitted to a computer that produces a graphical record. Achalasia, it's an uncommon condition with an annual incidence of 1 in 1 lakh. Both men and women are affected, more frequently in the middle and old age groups. Achalasia results from degeneration of ganglionic neurons within the mentoring plexus, which control the peristalsis and contraction. So also there's a failure of relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter on swallowing with absence of peristalsis in the esophagus. There's a high resting tone in the esophagus. Now coming to the Chicago classification, before we move for the Chicago classification, I'll be discussing about three terms. It is IRP, relaxation pressure. It basically tells us about the gastroesophageal junction relaxation. Then DCI, which is a contraction integral that measures the peristaltic force of the esophagus, and distal latency, which basically assesses the any esophageal spasm or premature contractions. So for the Chicago classification divides achalasia into three types, that is type 1, 2 and 3. Type 1 will have a very high IRP, that is the gastroesophageal junction relaxation will be high, that is more than 15 MFHG, and there is a 100% failed peristalsis, which means the DCI is less than 100. The normal DCI is between 450 to 8000. So here, if it's less than 100, it is a failed one. So in the type 2, the patient is also has pan-esophageal pressurization in 20% of the swallows, or more than 20% of the swallows. And the type 3 is spastic achalasia. Here also the IRP is more than 15 mm of mercury, and there are premature contraction. Here premature contraction with a DCI of more than 450 in more than 20% or equal 20% of the swallows. If the patient is having an increased IRP, but there is sufficient evidence of peristalsis and such that the criteria for type 1, 2, 3 achalasia not met, then we consider it as outflow obstruction. There are other disorders which I'll be discussing in the coming slides. So this is three types of subtypes of achalasia. Type 1, here we can see this absence of esophageal contraction. We cannot see any esophageal contraction the first one. All in the second one we see a pan esophageal contraction, as we can see here between the upper and lower esophageal sphincter there is a green line that tells about the pan esophageal pressurization. And the type 3 is a premature contraction. Here distal latency is less than 4.5 seconds. So it is a primary achalasia is idiopathic etiology, and secondary achalasia occurs in Chagas disease and following any anti-reflux surgery. Presentation is dysphagia to solids and liquids, and recurrent chest infections and regurgitation. Retrosternal chest pain can occur, and patient can have weight loss in long-standing achalasia. On the right side, they shows a image of achalasia that's a dilated esophagus with the bird beak appearance of the sphincter. Also, we can see that it shows retained secretion in the upper part. Investigation, flexible endoscopy is done to exclude cancer as any underlying problem. It also shows a tight gastroesophageal junction and dilated esophagus or feud within the esophagus. Barium swallow study will show delay in the passage of barium across the junction and possibly with the dilated esophagus that fails to show any peristaltic activity. Narrow rat tail at the lower end, that is bird beak appearance, is seen. In the manometric study, it shows lower pressure in the body of the esophagus and high pressure at the sphincter and failure of the sphincter to relax. On the images also, we can see the food residue in the upper right side in the esophagus, and the second image shows the dilated esophagus. It is basically a chronic achalasia, and which is sigmoid and tortuous. Also, this conventional manometry shows patient is having isobaric contractions which are not progressing. The waves are not progressing in all the in the proximal and the distal part. And as we can see, the lower esophageal sphincter shows contraction, shows high esophageal pressure. Treatment is graded pneumatic dilatation performed endoscopically, uses air pressure to dilate and disrupt the circular muscle fibers of lower esophageal sphincter. Barium dilators are available in three diameters, that is 3, 3.5 and 4 cm, and these are positioned over a guide wire endoscopy. After dilatation, all patients should undergo a diazotric acid swallow study followed by barium swallow to exclude any perforation. So this is an image showing a technique of pneumatic dilatation of achalasia. After passing the guide wire, balloon is placed over it and is dilated. Surgical myotomy can be done, that is an anterior myotomy across the lower esophageal junction, usually associated with an anti-reflux procedure like fundo application. Here muscles are split for 5 cm along the esophagus with myotomy extended into the cardia for 3 cm. Complication can be GERD 10 to 20% of the cases. Other methods are endoscopic injection with botulinum toxin or with pharmacological agents like nitrates or calcium channel blockers. And symptoms usually recur in more than 50% of the patients at 6 months. It is reserved for elderly patients for whom surgery poses a high risk. So calcium channel blockers and long-active nitrates are effective in reducing LES pressure, and they temporarily relieve dysphagia. They are short-acting and do not provide a complete symptomatic relief. And their efficacy decreases with time. So pharmacological agents are chosen for patients who are not candidates for pneumatic dilatation or surgical myotomy and in whom botulinum toxin injection have failed. Coming to diffuse esophageal spasm, these are simultaneous and repetitive contraction of the body of esophagus. Here the sphincter relaxation is normal. Dysphagia or dynophagia with substernal chest pain simulating angina pectoris can occur. Barium swallow shows a segmented esophageal spasm. As we can see on the right side, it is corkscrew appearance of the esophagus. Manometry shows normal relaxation of the sphincter on swallowing. Treatments are nitrate and calcium channel blocker and surgery very rarely performed, that is long esophagectomy. Okay, now coming to the manometry, as we can see here, the repetitive and simultaneous contraction are seen in all the parts of the esophagus, it's proximal and the distal and in the body of the esophagus. Coming to nutcracker esophagus, patient presents with a severe retrosternal pain during swallowing and the diagnosis is as shown in the conventional manometry, that is strong and high amplitude esophageal contraction are seen, but the they remain peristaltic on manometry. Ineffective esophageal motility disorder is a hypercontractile disorder. Here the distal esophageal contraction amplitude of less than 30 mm occurs in 30% or more of wet swallows. And as we can see in this manometry, they're either low amplitude or they're non-transmitted contraction. Higher incidence occurs in patients with GERD and especially in those with respiratory symptoms. Food bolus may not be effectively transported, resulting in dysphagia. This is again showing the ineffective esophageal motility, failed peristalsis in the esophagus. These are some images of other esophageal disorders. The first one is hypercontractile esophagus or jackhammer esophagus. Here we can see the distal contractile integral DCI is more than 8000 in at least 20% of the swallows. And the second image shows absent contractibility. We cannot see any contraction in the esophagus, a peristalsis in the setting of normal esophageal sphincter relaxation. Here IRP is normal, it's less than 10. Coming to secondary motility disorders, they are commonly as a result of systemic disorders like scleroderma, hypothyroidism, diabetes mellitus, amyloidosis. Scleroderma is a systemic collagen disorder with secondarily weakening of the smooth muscles of the lower two-thirds of the esophagus and LES. It has significant esophageal involvement and present with the symptoms of heartburn, regurgitation and dysphagia. Manometry will show a peristalsis as shown on the right side in the distal two-thirds of the esophagus and very low esophageal pressure. Barium swallow shows here on the right side as dilated esophagus, patellar gastroesophageal junction and free reflux into the proximal esophagus. They can have associated hiatus hernia or reflux esophagitis and may develop stricture due to recurrent inflammation. Treatment consists of acid suppression, dilatation and surveillance. In diabetes mellitus, predominantly they have a decreased peristalsis and decreased esophageal emptying. So because of this gastroparesis, patient may develop GERD symptoms. Treatment is with pro-motility agents that help the patients with gastroparesis. Hypothyroidism is another rare cause. Here also the manometry shows decreased amplitude and velocity of peristalsis. And it does improve with thyroid replacement therapy. In amyloidosis also, patient can have hypomotility, aperistalsis and decreased LES pressure. And now coming to gastroesophageal reflux disease, GERD is defined as a chronic symptom of mucosal damage secondary to abnormal reflux of gastric contents into esophagus. Reflux esophagitis is a subgroup of patients with GERD with histopathological demonstrated characteristic changes in the mucosa. Non-erosive reflux disease is the presence of typical GERD symptoms in a patient but without any endoscopic findings of of esophageal erosion. So in the spectrum of GERD, non-erosive reflux disease accounts for 50% of the cases, reflux esophagitis account for 30 to 40% and Barrett can account for 10 to 20%. Pathophysiology, it's a defect in the esophagogastro barrier, that is the lower esophageal sphincter incompetence.
transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxation and hiatus hernia. They're the primary factors which are involved in the development of GRD. So transient LES relaxation are short relaxation that do not occur in response to swallow. They are the primary mechanism for the gastroesophageal reflux in normal individuals and patients with mild GRD. In case of severe GRD and complication, here we should always suspect some permanent structural alteration like large hiatus hernia or low esophageal pressure. Delayed gastric empty can also be one of the contributing factors. Symptoms develop when offensive factors in the gastroduodenal contents like acid, pepsin, bile acids, and trypsin overcome the lines of defense, and including esophageal acid clearance and mucosal resistance. Symptoms are burning pain, retrosternal burning pain, acid regurgitation occur after meals, and they increase when the patient is in recumbent position. Patient may have dysphagia or rhinophagia and belching. Atypical GRD is called when the patient presents with symptoms like asthma, chest pain, cough, laryngitis, and dental erosions. Diagnosis, there is no diagnostic gold standard for this. So we always consider an initial empirical trial of anti-secretory therapy in the patient with the classical GRD symptoms in the absence of alarm signs like dysphagia or rhinophagia, weight loss, chest pain, and choking. Further diagnostic testing should be considered if the patient does not respond to the empirical course of anti-secretory therapy, or the patient is having any alarm signs. On the right side, we can see this esophagitis shown, and it's endoscopic view, and also because of that inflammation, the patient has developed a stricture. Again, this image is showing reflux esophagitis. We can see the erosions and ulceration are present at the squamous columnar junction. So the presence of esophagitis and the finding of varied esophagia are diagnostic of GRD. Clinical response to acid suppression is a good indication of GRD. Coming to the Los Angeles classification of grading severity of esophagitis, grade 1, as you can see this image, there will be one or more mucosal breaks no longer than 5 mm, and that do not extend between the top of two mucosal folds. So in the first image, we can see, as shown by the white arrow, there's only one mucosal fold. The second one also, image B, there's one or more mucosal breaks, but here it is longer than 5 mm, and they do not extend between two mucosal folds. In the C image, we can see that there are one or more mucosal breaks that are continuous between the tops of two or more mucosal folds. So we can see it's between the two mucosal folds, but involvement is less than 75%. In grade 4 and grade D, it involves more than 75%. So investigations like flexible endoscopic assessment can be done if the patient is over 50 years with new onset reflux, or when there's a change in the long-standing reflux symptoms, and to exclude malignancy. Further investigations to be done when the endoscopic appearances are equivocal and we are planning for a surgery, or when there is a suspected proximal reflux. Coming to the ambulatory 24-hour esophageal pH monitoring, it is an important tool in the diagnosis and management of GRD. It detects and quantifies the reflux and correlates symptoms with the reflux. So catheter here is passed through the nose and is positioned around 5 cm above the lower esophageal sphincter. Patient is encouraged to have a typical day without any dietary or activity limitation, and it is recorded every 6 to 8 seconds. So we calculate Dimister score. If it's if the score comes out to value comes less than 14.7, it's normal. Here we, what are the components of this Dimister score is percentage total time pH less than 4, percentage upright time pH less than 4, supine time pH less than 4, and the number of reflux episodes. Number of reflux episodes lasting more than 5 minutes or equal to 5 minutes, and the longest reflux episode in minutes. Now in the image on the right side, the first image shows the pH monitoring which is being done, and second image is a Brevo capsule which is placed in the esophagus. It is endoscopically placed. It is a non-catheter or a wireless esophageal monitoring. It has its own advantage, like it is records even for 48 hours and does not impair the daily activities of the patient, and it's more feasible. primary indications of this pH monitoring is document any excessive acid reflux in suspected GERD and evaluate the efficacy of any medical or surgical therapy. Images here shows Brevo capsules. So the data are downloaded to a computer that generates a pH tracing and a data summary. A reflux episode is when the pH drops below 4. This value is chosen on the basis of proteolytic activity of pepsin, which is most active at and below this pH. Results are generally considered normal when the total time that the pH is less than 4 exceeds 4.2% of the study period. On the right side, it shows a restrict kind of pH monitoring. Here it's oropharyngeal monitoring with it has a diode tip which can be seen, and it helps in the placement in the oropharynx. Is another way of doing a pH monitoring. So other investigation which can be considered are esophageal manometry. It will assess the efficacy of peristalsis and underlying motility disorders. Impedance studies it's done when the patient is suspected to have proximal reflux or non-acid reflux. Barium swallow to exclude any kind of dysmotility and demonstrate reflux. Coming to the complication of GERD, it can lead to esophagitis, mucosal erosion, hemorrhage, strictures, and Barrett's esophagus. In the lung, it can lead to aspiration pneumonia, chronic cough, asthma, and can lead to bronchostasis. In the larynx, it can lead to posterior laryngitis, hoarseness, repeated throat clearing, pachydermal laryngitis, which is basically thickening of the vocal cords, contact ulcers, granuloma, prostaglottic stenosis, and laryngeal spasm, and can lead to CA larynx. In ears also, it can lead to otitis media with effusion, and also there can be globus hystericus. So what's the treatment? We start with a diet and lifestyle modification advice, that is giving up smoking, alcohol, and avoid carbonated drinks, reduce caffeine intake and avoid fatty foods, and elevate the head of the bed at night. Also drugs that increase the tone of the lower esophageal sphincter, that is metoclopramide, can be used. Antacids, ergenic acid can also provide symptomatic relief of episodic heartburn. Ergenic acid basically derived from seaweed, and it can temporarily help. Other treatment methods are sucralfate, which is a complex metal salt of sulfated sucrose. It can be used in cases of mild cases. Histamine receptor antagonist achieve complete symptom relief in approximately 60% of the patients and heal esophagitis in 50%. For patient with GERD of these are used when the patient in cases of mild to moderate severity in whom highest rate of healing can be anticipated. For severe GERD, PPIs are chosen, and they maintain remission in 80% of the patient and is superior to H2 blockers, which only achieve remission in 50% of the cases. So step down therapy is done, that is patients are treated with PPIs, and once clinical response is noted, patients are treated with H2 blockers or PPI as needed basis. Surgery to be considered in cases when the patient presents with typical symptoms, just respond completely to anticipatory therapy, and when the patient is having a cause and potential adverse effects with long term PPI therapy, when there's a large hiatus, hernia, and predominant regurgitation symptoms, and in patients who have developed bronchiolitis obliterans in lung transplant patients. So here also we should go for anti-reflux surgery, because GERD will further aggravate the situation. So we do a nasal fundoplication, that is a 360 degree wrap combining with tightening of the crura. Complication can be there for this procedure, like dysphagia, chest pain, bloating, excess flatus, and esophageal perforation. Other surgeries are subtotal gastrectomy and Roux-en Y reconstruction, which is for intractable symptoms. Endoscopic therapies are also be considered, that is endoscopic suturing and injectable agents for bulking the gastroesophageal junction, like Enterix, which is not being used very commonly these days. And radio frequency energy can be delivered to the gastroesophageal junction, which improves the LUS pressure. Now this is a review article. This was published in the Department of Internal Medicine at Cleveland Clinic. It was published in April 2020. It gives how to manage how to manage gastroesophageal reflux risk. So when the patient present with the alarm, patient does not have any alarm symptoms, we start with the PPI therapy for 8 weeks and look at the response. If the response is present, we taper to the lowest possible dose. If the patient is having any alarm symptoms or if the patient does not respond to the PPI therapy, we have to go for a esophagogastroduodenoscopy. If it's abnormal, we have to treat in response to the findings. If it's normal, we have to then think of any extra esophageal symptoms, any associated symptoms. And if yes, we have to consider referral to ENT specialist. And if no, then we go for pH monitoring. In pH monitoring, if it's abnormal, we optimize our medical therapy and we can also consider other surgical endoscopic approaches. If it's normal, we have to consider that it's a functional heartburn or it is because of the hypersensitivity, reflux hypersensitivity. This is another study. It was given in Journal of Medicine. This basically the objective of this study was to perform a systemic review and meta-analysis to assess the effectiveness of the proton pump inhibitors for reflux disease in patients with laryngopharyngeal symptoms. After all the thorough research, 8 papers were identified and included in this meta-analysis, and total 370 patients were chosen, out of which 210 were taking PPIs and 160 were taking placebo. So basically, difference between the PPIs and placebo group in overall treatment of the patient was not really statistically significant. This is another review article about the historical perspective of gastroesophageal reflux disease. This was recently published in 2019 August, and they have told how there has been involvement from lifestyle modification towards a PPI. And finally, the conclusion of this study was the PPI are still like the first choice therapy. It has a good evidence in favor of the efficacy despite some safety concerns. Extraesophageal gastroesophageal reflux disease, it manifests as symptoms other than heartburn and regurgitation and include asthma, chest pain, chronic cough, laryngitis and dental erosions. So laryngopharyngeal reflux caused by the backflow of gastric content into the upper aerodigestive tract, and 4 to 10% of the patients who come to the otorhinolaryngologist do so because of the symptoms. So the GRD may be responsible for causing significant laryngeal changes that include erythema, edema, ulceration, nodules, polyps, granulomas, even leukoplakia and cancer. The three most common laryngeal findings are intra-arytenoid bar, arytenoid medial wall erythema and cobalt swelling of the posterior pharyngeal wall. The symptoms are as shown in the box, like dysphonia, difficulty in swallowing, globus, throat clearing, sore throat, cough, choking, thick mucus or post nasal drip, and spasm, laryngeal spasm. Laryngeal findings are seen in the patient with GRD, with posterior larynx and posterior pharyngeal findings being the most common. So there is no single sign which appears to be pathognomonic of LPR. Presence of though we say that presence of pseudosulcans, lincoedema, and symptomatic patient, mucosal, white line, nasopharynx are quite diagnostic of LPR. So what's the pathophysiology? Basically, in esophagus, we have a stratified squamous epithelium, which is resilient, and there are mechanisms that exist that physically remove and chemically neutralize the reflux bolus. But in larynx, we have a delicate squamous epithelium, and at other places, we have respiratory epithelium, which are less resilient. And so basically, refluxate is neither removed by peristalsis nor neutralized by bicarbonate. So also tissue damage is thought to be mediated by any activated pepsin and can occur very rapidly following exposure times in case of larynx. Gastric reflux contains acid, hydrochloric acid and pepsin, food residues, bile acids and bacteria. Reflux episodes may involve significant volume of the liquid gastric contents, particularly in the lower esophagus, but in the laryngopharynx they may be mainly gaseous containing fine aerosol, and they when they reach the laryngopharynx, it's very easy to have an access to the nose, nasopharynx and lower respiratory tract. Pepsin is secreted in the form of pepsinogen, which is inactive, and it is activated by cleavage in the acid medium. it goes and binds to the mucosa and is taken up by the epithelial cell by endocytosis. So basically by the repeated events, this can laryngeal reflux can happen. And so diagnosis is basically diagnosed on clinical grounds following outpatient assessment, including history and taking and clinical examination with endoscopy. We have a structural symptom questionnaire at every consultation we use, and the score is documented. Most commonly is RSI score, reflux symptom index. This is RSI score shown on the right side, and it is calculated on basis of this symptoms and graded on the on a scale of 0 to 5. More than 10 indicate a problem with LPR, more than 20 is moderate, and more than 30 is severe. This is another scoring, reflux finding score. Here we look at the following parameters of infraglottic edema, ventricular obliteration, erythema, vocal cord edema, diffuse laryngeal edema, commissural, posterior commissural hypertrophy, granuloma, and thick endolaryngeal mucus. It has a potential score of 26. More than 7 is considered to be the pathological treatment. So here again the PPI therapy is used. Here it is, the aim is to prevent the activation of pepsin by raising the pH, and also as the mucosal damage can occur with short-lived reflux episodes. In case of LPR, 24-hour coverage is necessary and twice daily dosage is needed. Symptomatic treatment may take much longer than in GRD, so a trial of 2 to 3 months is required, and a total time of approximately 6 months has been advocated in many studies. And advice session from a suitable trained speech and language therapist can improve compliance. Also, barrier agents like alginates can be used to protect the mucosa, and also patient can be given voice therapy. For the non-responder, we have to think if the diagnosis is correct, is the treatment regimen reasonable, is the patient complying with it. If the diagnosis of LPR is not clear, then further investigation should be carried out to confirm or refute it. And even if the diagnosis is clear, confirmation prior to referral for further management, like any reflux surgery, may be needed. Pepsin testing, 24-hour dual channel pH monitoring, and multi-channel interluminal impedance monitoring, which is another method of pH monitoring, should be considered. And a close check should be made on the treatment regimen to confirm the compliance. So this diagram is taken from Scott Brown, and it tells how to treat LPR. So we start with the diet and lifestyle changes. And for the mild cases, for all the cases, basically we give them alginate and potassium bicarbonate. And for the mild cases, that should suffice. In case of moderate, we give them PPI and low dose. And usually we start at 20 mg. And severe cases, we start with a high dose. And we reassess the patient after 2 to 3 months. And when the symptoms resolve, we step down the PPI. And the reduction schedule is given in here. We start with the 40 mg BD dose for 2 months, and followed by reducing the dose to 20 mg for next 2 months. And then to OD for the next 2 months. And finally, we can stop it. And then sometimes we can consider providing supply of this as needed. Before going to restaurant for a meal, we can take that. So most patients do not need to be on a long-term PPI. Only a small number of need some maintenance therapy. Also, dietary advice and Gaviscon Advance. Like Gaviscon Advance is basically alginate only, which can be used for treatment of reflux disease. So rebound symptoms are common stopping PPI therapy. In such cases, alginate can be given. This is another study which was given in Laryngoscope 2019 August, and by Michael et al. The aim of this study was to compare the diagnostic accuracy of slurry pepsin with oropharyngeal pH monitoring using the RESTEC measurement system, and some 70 patients were taken. Out of 70 patients, 41 subjects with the pathological Deminster score showed a higher mean value of pepsin compared to patient with a normal Deminster score. So the conclusion of this study came out as pepsin measurement could be an alternate tool to assist office-based diagnosis of LPR. It's quite good to use it. coming to eosinophilic esophagitis is also known as feline esophagus, ringed or corrugated esophagus, commonly present in young adults with food impaction and dysphagia, and we can see multiple rings in the endoscopic finding, and esophageal density is more than 15 eosinophils per high field on both the proximal and distal esophageal biopsies. It can have an association with atopic and food allergies, and a strong family history is present. Reflux disease should be excluded as underlying cause. Treatment surgery includes topical steroids and avoidance of any food allergens and dilatation of strictures. Coming to translational esophagoscopy, rigid esophagoscopy in clinical use was given by Adolf Kussmaul, and in 1957, a gastroenterologist named Hirschwag and his colleagues revolutionized the world of endoscopy with the introduction of first fibro-optic gastroscope. In 1994, Shaker published the first report of transnasal esogastroduodenoscopy with a narrow caliber flexible endoscope. So there is a high correlation between the endoscopic findings of TNE and conventional esophagoscopy, conventional endoscopy. Comparing both of them, we can see that TNE has a diameter between 3 and 5 mm. Despite its small caliber, it provides a working channel as well as an air inflection and suction channel. It's an office procedure, does not require sedation, and is more safer and more convenient for the patient. It's more cost effective also. It has a shorter procedure time, reduced recovery room time. And it has less fluctuation of physiological parameters like blood pressure, heart rate, and oxygen saturation. In case of conventional endoscopy, the diameter is around 10 to 12 mm and they provide a larger working port or multiple working port, but has a high cost associated with sedation, and also there are side effects of using sedation like aspiration, hyperventilation, vasovagal episodes, and airway obstruction. Indication for using this is esophageal indication like dysphagia, esophageal symptoms that occur that persist despite anti-reflux therapy. For Barrett's esophageal screening, for visualization and biopsy of any radiological abnormalities of esophagus and long-standing GRD. Extra esophageal indication also it is used for, and for routine screening of head and neck cancer patient, for taking any biopsy and any history of caustic ingestion, evaluation of any suspected foreign body, and monitoring of the varices. Also, it is used in morbidly obese patients for preoperative evaluation prior to any bariatric surgery, and also being used for checking the viability of free flap reconstruction of pharynx and larynx in immediate post-op. It also allows airway dilatation, percutaneous gastrostomic tube placement, laser fibers can also be used through this to ablate any kind of laryngotracheal lesions. And it's also used for voice rehabilitation in placing TEP. Patient preparation, it requires 5 minutes to perform, and anxiety and nasal pendency are critically important. It's an office-based procedure, and key success depends it should be a calm patient who has received adequate local and topical anesthesia. Nasal cavity is sprayed with topical oxymetazoline or either tetracaine and topical xylocaine for decongestion anesthesia. Nail per olor at least 3 hours beforehand to reduce the risk of aspiration, but recent oral intake is not an absolute contraindication. Complications, though very rare, can be epistaxis, vasovagal events, and nasal discomfort. These are the references. Thank you.